Hi, welcome to Got a Ping. I'm Mei Phing, the founder of Got a Ping. As a next-gen leadership coach, I help high-performing young executives and entrepreneurs like you to navigate complex people and problems with top-notch communication and leadership skills to create sustained success. In today's podcast, I want to share about my journey up the corporate career ladder in the past 10 years of me working in the corporate world. Recently, I've been getting some comments such as, oh, you look too young to have actually done anything in the corporate world at all. You look too young to have any real experience leading people and teams. So that was something I've been told very recently, and how wrong they are. In fact, yes, I've had a lot of experience, in fact, very intense experience as well. So I thought I'll share it via this podcast today, like a quick and nicely summarized story of my corporate career, the roles that I've taken, and some of like the key points around that, how I transitioned as well. So I'm originally a trained accountant, so I'm a chartered certified accountant by the UK and later on by Singapore. So I had the unfortunate timing of graduating in late 2008, early 2009. As you guys remember, it's the financial crisis, so pretty much there were no jobs available. I was still quite naive at the time. I didn't actually think about applying for roles that were related to my, degree or master's, if you will. What I did was I did a three-month stint at an events management company. So why did I join an events management company? Well, I thought, the corporate world is going to be tricky, it's going to be dynamic and fast-paced. Which industry is just like the extreme of all of that, if I would really want to learn something? So I thought, events, and it looks really fun on the outside, but let me just actually go and try it out. So I did an internship for 3 months. It was crazy. We were kind of launching a youth event in Penang, Malaysia, where I'm from. So I kind of joined some of the senior project managers, and we went visiting sponsors to get sponsorship for some of the events, for example, like the CSR activities where we're doing with the kids. We also went into negotiations with suppliers, who were supplying the stage equipment for some of the concerts and the booths and whatnot. So I would say that early on, I managed to pick up some of the skills such as like communication, negotiation, and of course adaptability, because what is constant in events, like everything changes all the time. So anyway, won't go so much detail into the job. Then after 3 months, I thought, okay, fine, it's time to kind of go back to what I was actually trained to do. Because in the accountancy course, you would need a relevant working experience before I can apply for like the license. So I joined a very small external audit firm in Penang. So this external audit firm not just covers like external audit, a little bit of internal audit, taxation. They also provided like accountancy services, some of the IPO launches as well. For the finance guys, I'm sure you know what I mean. I was there for about almost a year. While I was thankful that I had a job, it was definitely a very challenging one. So recently someone also asked me, like, did you, with your degree, get an accelerated role whereby you were just paid really well and then, you were earmarked for success or something? No, unfortunately not. So I started from ground zero, started from scratch. So joining this company, there were a lot of challenges also because it was a very small company. They hired a lot of graduates from local universities in Malaysia, and if you're familiar with the culture here, a lot of them, especially those who study accountancy, they used to study Chinese in school, or Chinese is the dominant language at home or at work and whatever not. So Chinese is not my dominant language. I actually speak a dialect, and I mostly speak English. So it was really challenging to get to know your colleagues and, you know, to actually communicate with them, because we are not exactly talking in the same medium, and, you know, the level of understanding obviously is quite different. So communication was challenged, and because of communication and maybe to me even listening skills as well, because when you can't fully understand a person's language and the way they express themselves, then it's quite difficult to actually listen very intently, because half the time you're just wondering what are they actually saying. So anyway, those were some of the big challenges. I got to run quite interesting portfolios as well, and I joined some of the bosses for client pitches, because I could present myself quite well, like in terms of the way I speak and so forth. So that gave me a little bit of an extra opportunity, even though I was with a very, very small company and started with an extremely low pay. Yeah, so after about a year, the economy recovered a little bit. I decided, okay, fine, I'm going to try to apply for, I would like to join a bigger accounting firm. So one of my colleagues had a friend in Singapore who kind of referred me to join Ernst and Young, which is one of the biggest global accounting firms in the world. And then I did. I moved to Singapore. I joined the Ernst and Young Financial Services Department. So this is the team. I mean, this is essentially the department that runs audit reviews of banks, insurance companies, fund managers, the actual fund administrators, and aside from that, a lot of regulatory compliance reviews. So I spent about 3.5 years at Ernst & Young, where I pretty much went up the ranks as well, started with a portfolio of a lot of random small companies that honestly nobody really cared about. But it was a lot of work, because every single company had a report. So if you are working on small companies, you had more reports to deal with. But if you're working for review a big company, essentially, it's only one report. So more hard work, time management was crazy. A lot of juggling multiple projects, multiple expectations, because how an audit firm works is it is highly matrix. So you may be working for several managers at one time. They are all responsible for their respective projects, and it is your job to run that. So while I was a senior there, I also had team members working for me on specific projects. So that was where leadership skills, project management skills, time management skills were all picked up. So I would say those are some of the key ones that I picked up. I also won't go very much into detail on that. After that, after about 3.5 years at Ernst & Young, there was an opportunity to join Visa. In fact, I discovered it on LinkedIn. I registered on LinkedIn in 2012. So 2012, and I kind of had a profile there. So in 2013, as I was sort of browsing the platform, I noticed that's an opening position at Visa, obviously it's one of the biggest payment companies in the world alongside with MasterCard and American Express. So I thought, okay, you know, it's a regional internal auditor role. As part of the role, I would get to travel, which is something that I love personally, and it seems like we get to interact with people from different cultures, which is also something I really enjoyed. So I went for it. I applied, got it after 6 rounds of interview, both in Singapore as well as colleagues in the US. So interview across like all levels, like directors and the VPs and everyone else. So I got the job. So when I decided to take the job, people think that I was crazy. Like, why would you move away from banking to join this payments company that's pretty much it's considered an MNC, but apparently not as prestigious as banking. How the tides have turned with all the fintech payment companies popping out now, but I digress. So I joined Visa. Initially, it was extremely fun because we got to travel every 2-3 months to visit a city where the main offices were located. So with Visa, I've been to Sydney, Tokyo, Shanghai, San Francisco, went to Foster City. I've also been to KL, Manila. So it was really fun. I traveled quite nicely as well on business class more than half of the time, stayed in very beautiful hotels. And more importantly, during the reviews, we got to really interact with the local colleagues and really learn about the cultures there, you know, and so forth. So it was really, really fun. So after almost 2 years at Visa, even when I was at Visa, I was really working on like different internal control projects. So really like picking up different skills as well. Because audit is audit. And audit sometimes is seen as a policeman and nobody actually likes that. So I was working on like kind of building controls, like building frameworks with one of my ex-bosses, really establishing a new process, a new department as one of the side things that I was doing. I was also helping my department head on reports that he would send to his boss, so kind of identifying the key points and being really able to articulate and collate and deliver that. So those were some of the things that I did. And after about 2 years with Visa, I got headhunted by Standard Chartered Bank in Singapore. So again, it was actually on LinkedIn. So I had a pretty nicely done profile and I pretty much got the call and asked me if I would be keen to join a newly established department. It's a pioneer team to work on some of the regulatory remediation that Standard Chartered was found themselves caught up in. And what they really liked was my previous experience as an auditor, so someone who is kind of very detailed. And I used to do a lot of reports as well, because for regulatory audits, you need a lot of reports for the government. Aside from that, they also liked that I traveled quite a bit across the region. So in terms of like being able to manage cross-border project, cross-cultural, all those sort of fit the bill. So I was headhunted and I pretty much got the job in after two interviews, which was great. And I jumped onto it. I initially started as a senior associate because they said that, you were never really in banking, so we couldn't start you with manager. So I said, okay, fine. So I started with a senior associate because I thought, what an amazing opportunity to join international bank. So I'm like, fine, I'll forgo the title for now and just like actually go for the opportunity. Then actually 3 months down the road, there was an opening for a manager. At a managerial level, and I was given it. So basically in 3 months, I did get the position that I wanted in the first place. So in terms of the role, what I did with Standard Chartered was I ran due diligence review across the regions where we would visit banks and assess their financial crime controls program and then provide some feedback on that. So these banks are actually clients of Standard Chartered Bank as part of the correspondent banking portfolio. So I did some travel around that. Of course, all the skills I picked up in audit were 100% useful because these visits are ran in a project mode, and at the end of it, there will be a report, there will be a list of suggestions, which is exactly what I did with EY. It's just that, of course, it's a different context, it's with a different company right now. So after that, I also I gradually transitioned to run to create reporting, to run governance committees and create reporting. So what that meant was that I was essentially chairing and managing the governance committees in charge of making decisions. So I would run those meetings, I would manage the presentation packs, I would liaise with all the stakeholders and make sure that's done. And similar to reporting as well, like identifying what needs to go into the report and really outlining it and presenting it in a way that it can be understood. And gradually, even from there, the bank decided to launch a multi-million dollar project to manage some of the challenges and the deficiencies that were identified. And I was selected to be the key stakeholder representing my team. I think I was maybe 26 or 27 at that time. So this is a multi-million dollar project. At the business side, I think, if I recall, like all my stakeholders were almost 40, if not 50-year-old, because they are CEOs of their respective departments, their business units, and these projects were all ran by were all involved by very senior directors. So I was like a really new junior manager and like, okay, fine, like, you know, I'm actually going to run this. So I did quite a lot of that. It was a really, really crazy time. We can't go into detail here, cause just too much. But you know, from the regional role where I was we were running around probably about 10 countries, I ended up running cross-functional projects, which include movement in 43 markets, as well as maybe about 20 departments in terms of like really getting people to deliver what they have to deliver, project tracking. I was working with the team, the regulatory team that were reviewing Standard Chartered Bank's controls, the regulators. I worked with too many managing directors that I cannot even recall how many they were. So many of them. Normally someone with my rank would not have been able to do. Yeah, but it definitely lots of skills that I had to pick up. And these are currently the skills that I advocate and I teach, you know, communication. You really need to listen to what people want because time is limited. You need to manage expectations very clearly, not just with your boss, but all the stakeholders. You need to make sure that you are getting along with everyone and you are able to create win-win relationships, because that's how you get sustainability in support, where people will want to support you because it benefits them as well. There's something in it for them. And in terms of like creative thinking, absolutely, because I was running a new team, so there were no, you know, existing framework or structure, so everything had to be built from scratch. Decision making very quickly as well, like, and very accurately, because every decision that we took had to be recorded, reported, and ultimately will be monitored and audited back to the bank. So at one point, I was pretty much the gatekeeper. So whenever I say go, and the report will 100% just actually go to the regulator itself, right? And then it will translate in a formal report back to the bank once a year. So that was what I did as a financial crime compliance officer with a lot of strategic projects under my belt. And I took a couple of month breaks in between because I had some personal issues back in Penang. So I went home, kind of took a break, spent time with my family. Then after that, one of the business stakeholder that I was working with asked me, hey, are you ready to come back with the bank? I would really want you to join my team. So this was the team that I heavily supported. So they were one of my key stakeholders, and essentially I did join their team. So that's why I continue to preach on how important is it to build win-win relationships, making sure that you are known and someone actually recognizes and sponsors you, because you never know when the opportunities will come. And if I had just blown off all my bridges, and like, why would, and in fact, this team is quite funny because as a compliance officer, I had to take very objective views. So sometimes I would say no to whatever that they wanted, but how interesting is it that they still actually wanted to hire me? So I thought that was quite amazing. So I did join the team. So it's partial risk management, partial business management, where we were already running portfolios. So this is the money-making side of it, the business. So the portfolio management, the communication with every single region for revenue numbers, as well as KPIs that they should not hit. So all in all, in total, I think we had about 43 markets to deal with. So I ran monthly meetings with all these respective regions, the leads. I also had a team that worked for me based in Singapore. I also had another team working for me in India. So the whole cross-border, cross-cultural, cross-timing as well. And a lot of people, I think at one point, I was probably working with like thousands of people at some point in time. My emails were constantly filled with like, I think I'd get about maybe 200-300 emails a day. So strive to keep that like a zero email policy wherever I can. So needing to make sure that you're sort of on top of everything. And yeah, and then gradually, you know, the whole fintech thing kind of, you know, zoomed up. So the bank took a strategic decision to actually build up this business. So I was already running the portfolio for the bank side. Ultimately, this fintech portfolio was also given to my managing director. So I was responsible to build up the entire governance committee for that, where, you know, it was highly protocol. So I had to do a lot of digging and, you know, seeing how structurally it would work and identifying all the key stakeholders, connecting with all of them, making sure that they are happy to participate in my committee, and really supporting that sort of end-to-end in terms of like decision making and what is in for them. So I won't go into a lot of detail because it will never end. I'm just now thinking of like all the stuff that I have already done, and it was crazy. And of course, you know, when you're managing people, everybody has their needs and everybody is different. So I also had to find time to coach them on their professional growth, even their personal growth as well, because sometimes like it's the personal stuff and their personal blocks that they're in certain habits for a really long time. It's affecting them professionally at work and not really vice versa. So that's what I normally recommend to my clients right now. You need to identify some of the habits that you have had for a long time that's interfering with how you're behaving at work, right? Because some of these things are not exactly picked up when you're working. It's just that you've really had it for a long time. And then after that, you know, I thought, yeah, I like a little bit more flexibility, and I like to return home to Malaysia, which I'm currently located. So I moved and I took up a professional coaching certification and kind of like, you know, really launched my coaching program and like my new life as a coach. So a lot of people also ask me like, you know, how do you know if your method works? Well, I always tell them, I know it works because I really made it work for me. And I don't think you can find many coaches out there who can really say, I've been there, done that. I know. I really know how you are feeling. And I really empathize with that because it is a situation that not many people understand. And I think that, you know, a lot of the clients that I work with, they are also very young, high performers, meaning that they have achieved, you know, they are in manager positions, director positions. They are the only young face there. Because when I was in meetings in the past, I was literally the only young person. And a lot of times I was mistaken as a secretary, which was really unpleasant. But it just shows you that is the reality. And that is something that you will just have to work through to command that respect and still make sure that people respect you and want to help you enough because you are valuable and obviously you deserve to be there, right? So, I mean, for me to say it in like 2 minutes sounds really easy, but of course, you know, when I work with my clients, we actually go through in detail as to how we can get there, and I understand their personality, what has made them successful, and then we can pivot from there because at a different level, the requirement is different. So if you were to behave exactly how you're behaving right now and expect the next level of success, it's not going to happen. Not going to happen. Yeah, so the lessons here is be open to opportunities. But once you have grabbed the opportunity, you need to actually level up because expectations are really high. You can't just say that, okay, yeah, you know, someone's going to teach me. No. So when people hire a high performer, you're expected to be high performing. Exactly. So whatever that you need to fix at the back end, right, you need to level up, you need to enhance, you need to improve all these skills, right, or clear thinking, be it time management, be it strategic thinking, like you actually have to go and fix it, right? And that's what I specialize in doing with my clients, and a lot of them are very ambitious, which helps a lot from an inner motivation perspective. It's been a really, really fun journey so far. And I'm fully aware that my corporate experience is very unique. So it can definitely benefit those who are really ambitious. They want to get to the next level. They are not happy or they don't think they'll be satisfied 10 years down the road if they're just stuck where they currently are. Aside from that, these are people who want to avoid knocking themselves on the wall. Like avoid embarrassment, avoid reputation problems, because if they were to try, which they can, but sometimes, you know, I always tell people in corporate, the reputation is not so easily redeemable. Once it's like tarnished, it takes a really, really long time for you to untarnish it, if you will. So yeah. That's a quick, well, I guess it's not exactly a quick story. I realize I've been talking for almost half an hour, but I hope you guys had a bit more understanding about my career and some of the challenges I've managed to overcome. And yes, anyway, finally, I forgot to say that, finally, I was made senior director at Standard Chartered Bank, which took me from the point that I joined probably about 4.5 years, which would normally take someone maybe 15 years. Yeah. Yeah, and I hope you got some insights from my story today. And if you feel that you are that person who could really benefit from my experience, you feel that whatever I said, you know, resonate with you, you think that this could be something that would help bring you to the next level. I spoke about some of the challenges that you're currently facing. Yeah, I mean, reach out to me on LinkedIn or, you know, send me a mail. And yeah, I would love to chat with you and see how I can help you. So, see ya. Bye. Thank you for joining me today. If we have not yet connected, I look forward to connecting with you. You can find me on my website, www.gotaping.com, on LinkedIn, as well as Facebook. The links to my profiles are in this episode's description box. I can't wait for you to join me in the next episode of my Gotta Ping podcast. Till next time, bye!